I'm looking at it as what can I do when I'm older? What can I do when my body fails me? What happens if I break a leg? You know, what happens if I throw my back out in the middle of the summer?
Today I'm coming to you from a very, very windy Jackson, Michigan. This is the home farm of Travis and Miranda Schuler. It's Great Lakes Permadynamics. This market garden all around me is about a third of an acre, and it makes up phase one of what's going to be a permaculture style farm in the long term. It's not all happening now. It can't all happen now. The reason why this is here though first is because this is something that can generate a lot of cash flow very quickly right away. And it's the cash flow from this operation that's gonna pay for the swales and the fruit trees that are going in at the front of the property. It's a gradual approach and it's one that Travis has really accepted. One thing I like about Travis after having him interviewed on the podcast, link to that below, is he's a realist when it comes to approaching these things. He doesn't necessarily do with what's popular or go after the thing you're supposed to go after. He does what works for him and his wife. That means starting small, starting on the side, doing this part-time, and growing into a system and growing his business. So this is an alternative look at how to take on market gardening. When you thought it should be this way, realize that it doesn't always have to be that way for everyone. Here's one way that it's working for somebody else, and maybe this way will work for you too. Travis, we're at your farm here in Jackson, Michigan. This is about a quarter acre. One thing that I find unique about your approach is you didn't set out to do this as a full-time thing. Can you talk about how this farm here in the background fits into your overall context?
This farm gives me an immediate income for the rest of my property. This little garden funds everything I want to do as you know, extras and bonuses like swales and berms and levees and ponds. The extra income I get from this can help me get started right away. You know, where this here where we're standing was 2 foot tall grass in March. I didn't have to desod it. I just came in and broke it up. I paid somebody, a neighbor right down the road, $150 to till it for me with his big pole behind tiller. I came in and formed the beds, and you know, there's $13,000 in profit out of that one little quarter acre, where in February and March, this had just been turf from the year before, overgrown, weedy turf.
So a big change coming from the beginning of the year to where you are now, $13,000 in net profit at the end of the day. You got a lot of crops here and you have some ideas between what you should grow the first year. Can you talk about that? And then can you also talk about what crops really worked well for you this year?
Yeah.
And what crops didn't work well?
Well, broccoli, spinach, radish, lettuce, any of the kale, the baby greens that we've grown, the cut and come again stuff has all been phenomenal. But, you know, we wouldn't know what's going to do good unless we planted enough to figure that out. And we knew going into the season that a good portion of what we put down isn't going to do good. It's not going to either, it's maybe not even going to make it to market. But we're at least gain the experience of knowing that we can't grow that product again, or we just better not worry about that right now because, hey, the spinach is doing good, the lettuce is doing good, the broccoli is doing phenomenal, and we can just focus on those if we can find a market for it.
Right.
You know, but everything else is a loss leader.
So a lot of it is just, it's work to learn, not to earn necessarily the first year.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, you're in a floodplain type area right here. You haven't grown here. This was a meadow a year ago. And you also aren't necessarily totally familiar with the market here. So start trying to get 100% success rate on what crops you grow on day one, not even realistic.
Yeah, it's not even going to, it's not going to happen. It's not a goal for me to even have. My goal is this year was to figure out what I can profit on better next year, what's going to grow more with ease and with less input and less work, and you know, how can I still continue to make a profit this year? You know, and we succeeded with that to some degree. I mean, I'm not going to go run to the bank and live off of my little bit of money I made on my garden, but it at least gives me the hope you know, that it is feasible and it is possible, and with the right outlook and the right marketing and the right attitude, you know, it's going to be doable, and we're going to be able to make it work.
Right. And if you think about a crop like broccoli, traditionally in market gardening circles, that's not a crop that you hear a lot of market gardeners talk about because of the whole value per linear foot of bed space. You're growing salad greens, that's profitable. That's one thing a lot of people talk about. How have you made broccoli work in your context?
We've removed the idea that you get a big main head. You pick a variety that's going to produce lots and lots and hundreds and thousands of side shoots per plant. So we put our broccoli at a 15-inch spacing, two rows per 30-inch bed, 15-inch spacing in between them. And that takes, 20 minutes to plant out. And we've harvested about 20 of the 26 weeks of market off of six beds of broccoli continuously every single week, having a good display of broccoli on our table from a small area. I mean, it's not a big area, and we just didn't focus on the heads of broccoli. And as a result from that, we've realized that we can charge more per bundle. For the same volume, the same weight that the guy gets from the big head, we can charge more because side shoot broccoli is tastier, it's more sugary, it's more tender, it cooks quicker, and it's not as fibrous of a stem as the big head broccoli is.
Right.
So it's actually a more premium product that produces more per square foot and with less work than, your big commercial varieties. But we're letting everybody else in market grow those big commercial varieties because everybody is, and we continually sell out of broccoli week after week after week for almost 20 weeks in a row.
So that's a lot of yield coming off those plants where you plant them once and you're just selling it by the bunch. All the side shoots come up, bunch it up.
We bunch the broccolini smaller. We bunch that real small. And I mean, that's a $5 bundle for something about 2 inches wide. We do the normal broccoli a little bit bigger because it's not as sweet and as tender. So we do bunches of that a little bit bigger for the same price.
Now, on the flip side of something that doesn't do well, you have tomatoes. There's a crop a lot of farmers count on tomatoes as like a big cash flow generator for their farm. What has been the challenge when it comes to tomatoes for you? And I'll kind of hint at one. There's no big polytunnel here in the field.
Tomatoes have been an absolute failure for us as far as profits earned per square foot, the amount of input we've put into attempting to trellis tomatoes and keep things pruned up enough. I keep hearing over and over again, all the people say that, tomatoes in your greenhouse that's what pays for your greenhouse, that you got to have the greenhouse because you can't make enough money without it. And that's not my experience. I just spent several months this summer slaving over a few tomato beds and making, pennies per square foot when something, like broccoli has paid dividends, when I can't get tomatoes to pay for me. And that may be because I have maybe too many farmers with tables full of heirloom tomatoes already at market. That doesn't have to just be for me.
You're just competing on price because supply is all over the market.
Yeah, we started doing two for a dollar on our slicer tomatoes because that was the only thing I could think of that would even set our tomatoes aside apart from everybody else at the market, because everybody at market does a basket or a bowl of cherry tomatoes or a basket of big slicers, and we just put a big display at the end of the table and, let people pick through it. And that was how we were able to start selling and move more volume of tomatoes, was just doing the two for one. You can pick which ones you want, big or small, have at it, and just let me know how many you grab.
So knowing that tomatoes have been challenging this year, when you're sitting down in the off season, do you think you'll grow them next year? How's that analysis going to work?
Well, every spring I seem to have some sort of a delusion about what I learned last year about certain crops. And this year was no exception of deciding to plant five beds of cucumbers or three beds of tomatoes, or let's plant a whole bed of peppers in Michigan outside of a greenhouse and get very little yield off of it. But then come next spring, I may be looking through a catalog and be tempted to plant another bed of tomatoes next year. And then next year I'll be licking my wounds at this time of the season, realizing how much of a waste of time it was to have tried yet again to profit on tomatoes. And this is our fourth year. I've not been able to make tomatoes worth it to pick. Whether they're in a greenhouse or not, my big problem is the time it takes to pick them and get them down to market, the weight, you know, carrying baskets of tomatoes out of the rows and out of the beds. It's not something I'm interested in doing for the rest of my life, you know.
So using your strategy then of the first year, you're going to plant a wide variety of stuff to see what works, and then hearing what you're saying, you know, learning these lessons and then applying them, how do you think this area will look next year when it comes time to plant it out? And then how do you think that'll affect revenue if things played out the same? Like, do you think that $13,000 net profits will go up next year on the same area given this change in strategy?
Every year so far, we've had an increase in the amount of money we've been able to pull off of the same size land, whether we were here or at our old farm. By doing more early season marketing and by maybe reaching out to some local chefs early on, I tried to do it too late this season and had missed my opportunity. Chefs had already found their farmers. I'm going to try earlier and try to build up a market for my salad greens and for my spinach, because hands down, that's the highest, you know, value crop I can grow here. And I grew too much this year with having only used maybe a quarter of the garden for greens. During the summer, I was taking home coolers full of spinach, coolers full of lettuce, and yeah, that's going to happen, but I was probably selling less than I was taking home. And that was discouraging, and that made me realize that you can only profit off your greens if you have a market to buy that much greens. You know, otherwise you need to have a diversity of things to where you're still gonna have stuff on the table that other people want. You know, because the goal is to get people in and talking to me and hearing the story and hearing how special our food is. You know, and I'm not going to get that if all I've got is greens and tomatoes on the table. Right. You know, I'm not going to, my outreach is brought way down when all of a sudden you've got nice bundles of red and white green onions, you know, and nice leeks, and you start adding new items to the table that bring new people in. And now I've got new customers and new regulars, and I'm stealing those people away from other farmers and getting their lettuce sales and their spinach sales, you know, and that's the goal. And you can't do that if all you've got is, you know, bags of greens or clamshells on your table. You know, that can only get you so many people in. When we know what big farms do at farmers markets, they pile tomatoes and zucchinis and everything as high as they can.
All the color.
Yeah, they've got the diversity, even though they don't expect to sell it all. Most of them have farmers markets, you know, 3, 4, 5 days a week. So I hear them saying all the time on a bad day, like, no, load that truck up for the next market, you know. They're just going to take it down the road for the next one, and they don't have as much loss as a small guy like I do.
Right. One thing you and I were talking about before we got recording was some of the basic equipment here that you used to get started. Now there's stuff you didn't buy and stuff you don't use here that saved you a lot of money, and then you spent the money that you did spend setting this up on a few different things that have really paid off by saving you a bunch of time. Can you first talk about that initial one? What you didn't buy and why you didn't buy it?
I didn't buy the BCS, and I didn't buy the big tractor with all the implements to go along with it, because at the time when I got started in this, I didn't have land of my own and a farm of my own. So my whole goal was to grow as much food as I could on the space that I was allotted by the person I was leasing land from, which wasn't much space. So I had to make do with what I had, and that meant deep prep, wide beds, you know, and which doesn't make a whole lot of room for, you know, for tractors and for implements and all that stuff. So, you know, this year, the big things was landscape fabric, drip irrigation, and then, you know, an electronic, you know, module to control all of my drip irrigation and the right, you know, electronic valves and everything with a big enough manifold to control everything automatically. That right there, I mean, that took out half of the work and the labor this year. It went into, you know, and that gave us time to go on vacation during the summer for the first time in 4 years. You know, we finally got to get up north in the summer and go swimming in the summer for the first time in 4 years, you know, and it's tough going year after year after year without being able to enjoy the summer months, you know?
Right.
And most farmers have that problem.
You know, this is a small land base. This is part-time. We'll get into talking more about that later. with the tools that you have, the minimal tillage, how much time are you and your wife spending on this area per week?
Collectively, about 20 hours a week.
So 20 hours, and then you're netting about 13 grand off of this a season. Of that 20 hours, are you including the farmer's market day in there?
Well, partially. We don't put 20 hours of labor in here a week. But in the spring, it's probably over 20 hours. In the middle of the summer, it's less than 20 hours, with market included, because in the summer, we come out here, we pick for 2 hours, gang bust, and we've got a truck full of produce.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Together, because it's just me and my wife, we're doing everything. We know where everything's at, how everything's done. I mean, me and her can... we can get some serious work done in a very short amount of time.
Yeah, so it's a nice little side operation here.
Yeah, it's that's what this was supposed to be, because when we get the rest of the farm producing an income, all we'll have is time for a side job for the annual garden, you know? And I do not want an annual garden as a full-time job. I do not want a market garden exclusively for a full-time job. I will kill myself.
You know, for you, why is that? You know, certain people love this space. I think you like it, but you've realized you don't like it enough to want to do it full-time, you know, 40, 50, 60 hours a week. Why is that? Because I think that's an important point.
Well, because most of the summer months, working in the garden is being bent over at a 90-degree angle, bent over a 30-inch bed, and at the end of the day, you feel like you've been riding a horse because your legs have been spread out over that bed all day. You know, it part of it's the physical aspect of it, that I know that if I put all my eggs into the annual market basket, by the time I'm 40, I'm not going to be able to do this kind of work anymore. Now, that may be where you'd want to get into having a mechanized garden completely and that whole thing. But, you know, I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing if I took on the debt and the machinery to start doing that now. Right. That might be an option for the future, but I'm looking at it as what can I do when I'm older? What can I do when my body fails me? What happens if I break a leg? You know, what happens if I throw my back out in the middle of the summer? Which is inevitable. It's going to happen, but how much can be done without me doing it when that does happen? How much is going to die when I'm not there to take care of it? And perennial food forest is not just going to die if I can't tend to it for a half a season or a full year. You know, it's going to continue on, and I'll just have to make up on pruning next year, you know? So it's... for me, the whole point is to try to design a system where there's enough diversity and enough income streams throughout the whole thing to together equal an income that will pay our bills, pay our health insurance, and be enough. You know, and all we need is enough. We just need enough to get by, and that enough needs to come easy enough to not break our bodies along the way and be capable of doing when we're older and at retirement age and maybe don't have the money to just stop working entirely, you know. So by having a forest that produces food for us year after year after year, regardless of whether we're able to get into it or not, because we can pay some neighbor kid to come over and pick apples for us or, you know, whatever it may be.
Sure. So the greater picture here is this isn't just about market gardening for you guys. It's the market garden is one component that plays a very specific role in the overall usage of the land base. It provides cash flow now, as you're saying.
Yes. This is the only element and component of the farm right now, but it should be the first component of the farm for just about any farm, because what else can you do to have an immediate return on your land other than annuals? I mean, there are, you know, you can do some broiler chickens and maybe do some pigs, but all of those require far more input than this does right here.
Yeah. Right. So while you're developing this, using the cash flow from this, you can start installing the food forest, which you're putting some swales in today. We can show that in a little bit and get that system moving. And then fast forward ahead 10 years, 20 years, you have a bunch of little enterprises on this 10 or so acres that you have, all making up one complete income of just enough.
Yeah. Yeah. All we need is enough. And a quarter acre market garden is a great step towards the direction of having enough, because I say this all the time, but, you know, even if everything fails, at a bare minimum, hopefully you at least learn something you did wrong. You know, so you can't know what to do right until you've done enough wrong, until you've failed enough times. And, you know, a quarter acre market garden is a great start for having plenty of failures and plenty of successes, you know, and that's what you need to get. You need the failures for the experience and the knowledge, and you need the successes to keep your willpower high enough, you know, so that you don't give up in July and August when it's really tough to get out there and have to work through 100 degree heat to pick tomatoes and cucumbers. So what we did here was we had a lot of water flooding downhill into the garage over the course of the winter and into spring, and a couple of the big storms this summer have done the same thing. So getting these swales done and getting the soil subsoiled was our attempt to stop a lot of the water that's coming downhill behind us here, and at the same time give us a great place to start a lot of our food forest and our polyculture and get a lot of nuts and edible perennial, you know, fruits, nuts, berries, fiber crops, medicine crops, and really start getting that food forest put together, because you know, the annual garden is only so much and is only one facet of the whole system. You know, I do not want to have this whole hill behind us here in annual garden. I'd rather this be a low maintenance food production system that I rarely have to do anything to.